Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus. Lord, tonight we thank you. We can come into your house and have the joy of the Lord, which is our strength, the joy of our salvation, God. It's just a pleasure to be in the house of God, experiencing your presence and your power. Tonight, Lord, we don't want to have just business as usual. God, we want to be equipped so that when we leave this place, we can go and be the church. Do what you've called us to do. Be everything you've called us to be. God, that we can carry the message of our Savior, Jesus Christ, to a lost and dying world. Tonight, Lord, as we open your word, we pray that you open us up to receive it. Open our eyes to see, our ears to hear, our hearts to have a good understanding. May we be the good ground where the word is sown. May it produce something in each and every one of our individual lives. Tonight, God, we praise you and thank you, God, that your Holy Spirit is here. We acknowledge him as the teacher of the church, not a man or a woman, not the young or the old, the black, the white, the brown, any other color we could imagine. We've come to hear from you. So welcome, Holy Spirit, be our teacher, be our guide. Give us your vision, your wisdom, your instruction, your direction, even your correction, Lord, and we'll thank you for it. God, it's good. Lord, we don't just ask this blessing upon ourselves, also we'd ask it for all the churches, both here in the Inland Empire as well as around the planet, that are preaching and teaching the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. God, we would ask that you bless them and be amongst them as you are, blessing us and being amongst us, God. Thank you, Lord, that it doesn't matter their background, their denomination, Lord, if they're lifting up the name of Jesus, preaching your gospel and your truth, that there you are in their midst, God. And we ask for their blessing, we ask for their encouragement, their strength, God, in Jesus' mighty name. Lord, we don't forget our persecuted brothers and sisters scattered abroad throughout the world. We ask that you protect them, bless them, encourage them, strengthen them, deliver them, Lord. May they endure to the end. God, we praise you and thank you. In Jesus' mighty name, we're all in agreement and we say, amen. 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 Well, tonight's going to be a great night. You know, it is May 4th, and some of you guys know about May 5th, but you don't know about the lesser holiday that's being celebrated by pop culture, May 4th. In fact, this is International Star Wars Day, is that right? Where are the geeks, the nerds, the... Okay, some of you guys out there, May the 4th... Oh, look, she's got the hat on. May the 4th be with you. Why do I say all that? Here's why. Is because I was taking a look at a topic, and we're going to talk about it tonight. And I went on a website. It's a website that you can promote any sort of a cause, maybe something that you want to get done, something you want to have happen. And it's called change.org, and you can start a petition for people to sign up for something in order to promote that change or that cause. You know, there's a lot of these types of websites. Many of them, you know, are identified with money, that sort of a thing. And I thought this was interesting in the sense that it was just to petition, just to get stuff going, get stuff rolling. They've gotten into politics. They've gotten people out of jail. They've done all this kind of different stuff. And as I was reading about this today, I read a very interesting statement from them that I thought I would read about today, since it's the 4th. It says, nearly 300 Star Wars petitions have been started on change.org between 2011 and the end of 2015. Almost 58% of those petitions were started in the last year. In other words, the movie was coming out, and so everybody started getting excited and started doing petitions about Star Wars. And it says 80 of those petitions were started about Star Wars in the last 3 months. Now, while many of those petitions came in from the U.S., 44%, to be exact, of people have started the petitions about Star Wars were in 35 other countries. Star Wars geeks and nerds, you are not alone. There is a worldwide alliance that is all about this right now. So Star Wars fans are everywhere. Now, one of the most touching Star Wars petitions that won about a month ago asked Disney and J.J. Abrams to allow a fan named Daniel Fleetwood to see The Force Awakens before its release. Fleetwood was a fan of the franchise since he was the age of 8. He was diagnosed 2 years ago with a rare connective tissue cancer, and they feared he would not live until the release of the movie on December 18th. With the support of Mark Hamill, Carrie Fisher, and John Boyega, and lots of other Star Wars fans, Fleetwood was given an early screening before he passed away in early November. See, it's kind of interesting to me that someone can get on a website, someone can have an idea, someone can desire something and want something, and they can start a petition that goes to people all over the world. And people can get behind that and respond to that, and they can bring about a change in life, a change to their world. Now, change is one of those big topics. I think I've heard a lot about change. I mean, all you have to do is go online or take a look at the news and maybe listen to the latest politician giving their speech or whatever it is. And what are they talking about? They're talking about change, how to change things, what to do to make change, what they're going to do to make change. Vote for me and I'll change, right? But tonight I want to talk to you about a subject called doing godly change. See, there's a difference between just having change just because you have a desire, and a change based on what God wants for your life. When you get a hold of the Word of God and you find out about how to bring about a godly change, all of a sudden the world that you live in is going to become something that God envisioned for your life. How many of you know God can dream up a better future for you than you can? Okay, praise God. I'm glad we're all on the same page with that. Because I look at my own life, the things that I desired, the things that I wanted growing up, you know. Every child gets asked, what do you want to be when you grow up? And we always, you know, you never hear people say, well, I want to be stuck in a dead-end job, and I'd really like to not be, flown with my husband or wife. I'd like some tension there. I'd like to have my kids on my back and just don't really, connect. No one says that. What do we want to do? We want to be a fireman. We want to be a policeman. We want to be an astronaut. We want to be a president. We want to be something big. We want to make a difference. We want to make a change. And you can ask any child, go over to our children's ministry tonight when you're picking up your kids, what do you want to be when you grow up? And they will most likely have a brilliant answer, or maybe it'll be a funny answer like my son, from the time he was about age 3 till about age 5, somewhere in there, we would ask him what he wanted to be, and he wanted to be Mickey Mouse. I guess you can be that when you grow up, son, if that's really what you want to do. Yeah, you want to be Mickey Mouse? Yeah, but I think it was different. I don't think he wanted to put on the head and the outfit. I think he wanted to be Mickey Mouse, because he was watching the programs and saw all the stuff he did and thought, that is what I'm talking about right there, man. But for all of us, if I were to kind of break away the walls, break away the years, break away the cynicism of life and the jaded responses all of us would bring, at your very core, if I was to ask you tonight, what sort of change would you like to bring to your life? All of us would have something. Maybe it wouldn't be an astronaut. Maybe it wouldn't be Mickey Mouse. But maybe there would be something that we would be able to say, you know what, I'd really like to do this. I'd really like to be the dad that I never had. I'd really like to be the wife that my husband deserves. I think I'd really like to be the Christian that God wants me to be. I'd like to be an evangelist. I'd like to be a teacher. I'd like to be someone who makes a difference, that when I die, people are crying. I don't want people, to not miss me when I'm gone. I want people saying, man, that guy left. Wow, the world is going to mourn for that person, right? We want to make a difference. So how do we bring about godly change? Well, I'm going to give you 4 words that start with the letter D, okay? That's how I think. I remember stuff that way. Hopefully it helps you. If you don't like learning that way, find some way to learn and get a hold of this tonight, because it's going to change the world that we live in, okay? How do we bring about a godly change? First thing is this, is that you've got to have a desire. Change will not start until you want something. See, sometimes we get so brain dead and we allow the world to tell us so much stuff. You have to be this way. You have to do this. You have to do this way. You have to eat these things. You have to not eat these things. You have to look this way. You have to talk this way. You have to act this way. You have to do money this way. You should do education this way. That we don't make any decisions for ourselves, and we never bring about change because we're kind of on the lazy river of life floating down wherever the current takes us. And yet, I don't believe God wants us to live that way, just kind of brain dead, floating around in time and space, and hopefully we can make a difference. No, God has purpose. God has passions. God has desires that he wants to bring on the earth. And sometimes people say, well, why doesn't God do that? Here's why. Because we're the body of Christ. God is moving and living and breathing and acting through his church. Now, before we get the wrong idea, church is not the building. Church is not the Rock Church and World Outreach Center and Harvest and The Grove and all these different organizations. No, church is the people. Church is the Christians. And so God says, I want you to have a desire. What is it that you want? That's the first question we should be asking ourselves. And then the second question right after that is what I want godly? Because we're talking about bringing about godly change, right? See, in the natural, sometimes we want something, but we don't want it the way God wants it. Or we want something that's ungodly. Or maybe we see that something's good, and the only way we see we can get it is by ungodly means. See, if it doesn't match that criteria, if it doesn't pass the smell test, if what you want when you look at it smells funky, stay away from it, right? Because if you went to your refrigerator and you wanted some milk and you pulled out the milk carton, you opened it up and you gave it the smell test and it smelled funky, you wouldn't drink it, right? Hopefully you wouldn't. Some of y'all would, and you'd be wondering why your stomach was hurting later. But in our life, if we can take our desires and we can say, well, what is it that I desire? You know, young men, some of you guys, I'm desiring a godly wife, right? Okay, is that a godly desire? Well, yeah, we can find that in the Word of God. Okay, now how? Well, I like her. Well, she's married. You can't have her. Ungodly. Answer is no. Change that desire. Get off of that, right? But if you want something, sometimes people say, well, I want to prosper. Okay, that's fine. You can find that in the Word of God. How are you going to do it? Well, I'm going to work hard. Okay, we can find that in the Word. Then get after it. See, what is it that you want? Sometimes we need to just stop and take a moment, take a breath, and just take a look at our lives and say, where am I at? God, just show me where I'm at. You know, the psalmist, he was writing and he said, God, take a look at me. Everything's open to you anyways. I can't go anywhere. I can't run anywhere from your spirit. You formed me in my mother's womb. You know me. You knit me together. So God, try me. Test me. Know my anxious thoughts. And then he says, and lead me in the way everlasting. See, get alone. Get some time. Look at your life and take a look at what you want. Chances are you already know what you want, number one. And number two, you already know if it's godly or ungodly. If it's ungodly, get it out of there. But if it's a godly desire, then it's time to do something about it. You got your Bibles, right? Psalm chapter 37, turn there with me. Psalm chapter 37, great psalm. If you want to just take some time and read the whole thing this week, it'll just bless you. It'll encourage you. I want to just take a look at one verse in Psalm 37, verse number 4. Look at what it says. Psalm chapter 37, verse number 4. First in verse 3, it says, trust in the Lord. Now it says in verse number 4, delight yourself also in the Lord, and he shall give you the desires of your heart. Now, I used to wonder about this because I thought, well, how can God do that? How can God just give me whatever I want? You know, it almost feels like sinful, you know, right? Like, because we feel like we shouldn't have anything that we want. But look at the first part of that verse. Delight yourself where? In the Lord, right? See, if you are delighting in the Lord, that means that when you hear about something that's godly, something from the Word, something that you see that you know is true, that you know is proven, something that you know is of God, and if your heart leaps at that, and that's what excites you, that's what lights you up, that's what puts you on fire, then look at what it says, and he shall give you the desires of your heart. Why? Because you're already in line with God once for your life. So we can know, God, I want change in my life. I want something to happen here. God, I want to see a difference. And if your life is a delight in the things of God, then that change that you want, God says, well, then you can have it, right? It's like my children, Daddy, I'm hungry. Okay, well, I know you need to eat. Now, what do you want to eat? Cookies. No, you can't have cookies for dinner, right? Then ice cream. No, not ice cream. But if my kids come to me and say, Daddy, I'm hungry. Okay, well, you've already had dinner. You want a snack? Sure. What do you want for a snack? Celery. Absolutely. All day, every day, right? Any parent would be like, here you go. Might even say, you want some peanut butter on that? Little raisins? Ants on a log? What do you want, you know? Why? Because it lines up with something you know is good for your kids. God is no different. He's not going to harm us with desires. He's not going to harm us. He's not going to give us something that will put us in a bad spot. So delight yourself also in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. But we can't just stay at desire. We have to, number two, second word that starts with the letter D is this, decision. You got to make a decision. Now, I'm preaching to the pastor right now, because if anybody knows me, it takes me forever to get there on certain issues, right? I was talking to a guy just this week, and he said, you know, I work with this guy, and man, it's tough because I'm a microwave, and he's a crock pot. And I said, amen, that just describes me to the T, right? I'm the crock pot guy. It takes me a long time to heat up and warm up to something. Takes me a long time to get there. I have to gather all the information. I want to, you know, when I have a meeting, I want to call six people in the room and say, hey, what do you guys think about this, right? Because I want to get the tone. I want to get the pulse. I want to take some time. I want to go pray about that. Let me go get with God on that. Let me find out what God has to say. And sometimes people get mad at me. Why are you stalling? Why can't you just pull the trigger? Why can't you just make a decision? And that's okay. Sometimes I need a little kick in the pants and need to get going. But see, The point is that eventually I will come to a point where I make a decision. See, if you're sitting here and you're saying, I want, but you never cross over that line and say, I'm going to do this, and you never settle it in your heart that this is the decision that I've made, then you're not going to get anything. You're just going to sit there in dreamland and hope and hope and hope, and you're going to hope amiss. You're going to ask amiss. Why? Because you've never settled it. That's exactly what I want, and I'm making the decision. I am going to have that. I don't know if it's fear that holds us back from that. I know me personally, I've dealt with that. Well, maybe if I want it, but then I say it, and then I don't get it, then I'll be disappointed. But listen, what are we so afraid of? Being disappointed? We've been disappointed all our lives, haven't we? You know the person you were voting for on that television show didn't get voted on, right? So you were disappointed. We deal with it on a daily basis. You didn't get the seat that you wanted in church tonight because some jerk came here early and sat in your seat tonight. We deal with disappointments all the time. Life happens. There's a devil out there that hates your guts. You're not always going to get what you want. And yet, that doesn't mean don't make decisions. That doesn't mean don't strive for change. That doesn't mean stop and just allow whatever to happen to happen. No, figure out what you want and then make the decision. I'm going in that direction. Why? Because it's godly. And I know that if I can find it in the Word of God, I can have it in my life. Ooh, somebody write that down. That was a good statement right there. If I can find it in the Word of God, I can have it in my life. Can you say amen? See, too many desires are never realized because we can't make a decision to go for it. Do you have a strong will? Or a strong will not? Think about that for a second. Because some of us have a strong will. I'm going to go do that. I'm going to get after it, right? But some of us have a strong will not. I won't. I just won't do that. I'm not going to go after it. You're there in the Psalms. Maybe keep your finger there. We're going to come back to the Proverbs in a moment. But Acts, the book of Acts, chapter number 26. There's an interesting story that it gets to me every time I read it. Acts, the 26th chapter. Paul is been imprisoned in Jerusalem. Now he's been transferred over to Caesarea. He keeps going before these different guys. He's talking to them. He has favor with them. They're trying to listen to what he has to say, trying to see what's going on. They can't find any fault in him. Acts, the 26th chapter. And in Acts 26, verse number 28, take a look at it with me. It says this. The king's name is Agrippa, okay? And he's talking to Paul, and Paul's witnessing to him. Paul's saying, you need to give your heart and life to Jesus. He's really going after him. And look at what it says. Acts chapter 26, verse 28. Then Agrippa said to Paul, look at this. You almost persuade me to become a Christian. Now, that's probably one of the saddest statements in the entire Bible. Why? Because almost persuaded is still totally lost. Are you listening? See, we never get a record that Agrippa finally crossed over the line and made the decision. That means if he never surrendered his heart and his life to Jesus and rejected when he had heard the gospel given to him plainly on a daily basis, he had the witness, he had the understanding, then God is just in his judgment over his life. And Agrippa would be in hell today because he was almost persuaded but never crossed over the line and made a decision. See, in our lives, we have to be careful about our intent, that it doesn't just stop at desires. What is it that you want? Do you want to be free from sin? It's time to make the decision to stop it. Do you want to have a better marriage? It's time to make the decision, make the choice, step over and cross the line. Don't just let it be a desire. Don't just wish I had a better marriage. No, make the decision. I'm going to have a better marriage. You want to prosper in your business? It's time to stop wishing. And why does it only happen to the startups? And I read all these great stories about these guys in their garages that hit it big and, you know, the dot-comers guy. Why can't I just win the lottery or something like that? Listen, it's time to make a decision. I am going to prosper. It's not going to be like this forever. Cross over the line and make the decision for change. Are you listening tonight? Third thing, not only desire, not only decide, make a decision, but then diligence. Diligence. It's time to get after it. Once you've crossed over the line, who are you going to include and tell about that decision? It's going to keep you accountable. Think about it. If you want to have a better marriage, and you desire a better marriage, and then you decide, I'm going to do it, then you got to get after it, right? So the first step to that is, who am I going to tell about this? Well, I have a good suggestion if it's in your marriage. You tell your spouse. If anybody's going to keep you accountable, hello, and I'm especially speaking to the men right now, it's going to be your spouse. How many of you men know she won't even let up on the laundry list, right? She's got something. She's going to talk to you about it. She will remind you of it. And you are going to be reminded, maybe sometimes in an unpleasant way, hey, I thought you were working on your marriage, sucker. She'll tell you. But okay, so I'm going to stop sinning. I'm going to stop this area of my life. I'm going to get off drugs, whatever it is. Who are you going to tell? Who will hold you accountable? Who can you call and say, I'm struggling? Who is going to be the one that can tell you no? No, you said you were going to make a decision. I'm going to hold you to it. You can't go to the bar. No. You can't go to the club. No. You can't call that old flame. No. See, who is it that you're going to tell? You're going to prosper in business. Who are you going to tell? Listen, I'm believing God. I want to work hard and I want to go after it. See, it's time to get after it. That means a whole lot of hustle. Are you listening? It's time to get after it. Time to do something with it. You still got your finger there in the Psalms. Turn over to Proverbs. Turn over to Proverbs, okay? Proverbs chapter number 19, verse number 24. Proverbs chapter number 19, verse number 24. Great verse in the Bible. It says this. It says, a lazy man buries his hand in the bowl and will not so much as bring it to his mouth again. Isn't that a great verse? Can you picture that? Let's illustrate it. The ushers, you guys got the bowl? Bring it on up. Bring it on up. You got it right there, Daniel? Okay, bring it on up. All right. Okay, so to illustrate this point, come on. Here we go. Anybody like Sun Chips? Anybody like Harvest Cheddar Sun Chips? Ooh. Anybody drive here and didn't have dinner that would like some Harvest Cheddar Sun Chips? Now, he's raising his hand, and she's got her hand on her face like, no, don't point at me anymore. You right there? Come on up here, okay? Let's illustrate this. All right, yeah, give her a hand. What's your name? What is it? Odessa? Very nice to meet you, Odessa. Come on up. Have we met before? How long have you been coming to The Rock?
For like about 7 years.
7 years. All right, Odessa. I've been here for 7 years. That's awesome. Okay, Odessa. The Bible says a lazy man, so you're a woman.
Ain't all God's children?
All God's children, men. Yeah, there you go. So, lazy person buries their hand in the bowl. Go ahead and bury your hand in the bowl. Get it in there. Okay, so you're going to bury it. Kind of hard to do in the chips, huh? All right. Now, are you hungry? Mm-hmm. You haven't eaten tonight, right? How far did you drive to get here?
I caught the bus.
She caught the bus. That's awesome. Church bus. Hey, all right. That's cool. So, you hungry? Mm-hmm. Yeah? And you like these chips, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah? Harvest Cheddar. These are good. They smell good. Oh, no, no. Don't put my nose near it? Okay. Odessa has a desire. She made a decision to get in the game. She's in there. Okay, I can see her hand is buried in the bowl. But a lazy person buries their hand in the bowl and will not so much as bring it to his mouth again. See, there has to be diligence. If you want to eat of the fruit of your labor, go ahead and bring a chip on up. I know you got one in there. Do you got one? Oh, look at, she's got a handful. Okay. Go ahead and eat it. Eat it. Come on, let's hear the crunch. Oh, there it is. There it is. You want this bowl? Mm-hmm. I need this part back. Mm-hmm. Odessa, do you have your Bible and stuff with you? Mm-hmm. Is it all the way up there? Mm-hmm. Okay. I tell you what, I'm going to give you an upgrade. Why don't you come sit up here on the front row, okay? And go get your stuff or have an usher. Can we have an usher bring up her stuff? Okay, we're going to give Odessa an upgrade on the seats tonight. Do you have any friends with you?
No, not tonight.
Do you know anybody in here?
Yes, I know a lot of faces.
Okay, a lot of faces. Do you know any names?
No.
No names. Okay. So maybe point to a couple friends, maybe two. There's three seats right there, okay? And if you want to share with Angelina Aguilar, you can. But if you want to invite another friend up, and they'll sit on the side, and you guys can eat these chips during church, okay? We'll let you guys do that. All right? Let's give Odessa a hand. See, a lazy man buries his hand in the bowl, and he will not so much as bring... Who else is hungry here tonight? You guys hungry? Oh, look at you guys. Here, why don't we pass this around a little bit, okay? And you guys can have some chips in church tonight, okay? Pass those around. All right, who's got some? All right, you got something right there? All right, who's that? Okay. Oh, wait, there you go. You got the bowl. Look at, she's diligent. She's diligent. Yeah, she's diligent. Look at that. See, if you want something, you got to get in the game. You got to go after it. You can't just sit back and want something and not get after it. Are you listening tonight? Come on. Oh, this side needs. Oh, look at, she's on her feet. See, you can't just desire something. Look at, all right, he's coming on up to get some. There you go. Okay, all right, here we go right here. You got to get some. We can't just sit back and let the devil beat us up any longer, church. You got to get after it. Can't just sit back and I wonder why other people are getting blessed and I'm not. Here's why. Because the lazy man buries his hand in the bowl and he won't even bring it back up to his mouth. God has something for your life. He's got wisdom. He's got strength. He's got instruction. He's got blessing. He's got direction. He's got provision. He's got everything you need. And the church has buried their hand in the bowl for too long and just left it sitting there. I wonder why I'm not getting blessed. Get your hand up to your mouth. Come on. Can't just be sitting there like a sloth. Proverbs. Still in Proverbs, chapter 13, verse 4. The soul of the lazy man or woman desires and has nothing. But the soul of the diligent shall be made what? Rich. This is not get rich quick. This is don't be lazy. Because the word of God says the soul of the diligent shall be made rich. I don't know how long that takes. And for most of us, it takes time. I did not become who I am or do what I do overnight. I followed Jesus diligently. And over 20 years of serving the Lord and following him, I finally am at a place where I'm starting to get a hold of the Word of God and seeing these principles, seeing things come to pass, seeing God bless things. There's stuff going on. I mean, you just got to get after it and you got to stay after it. Which brings us to the last thing. The last D for tonight is this, is determination. Not only desire, not only decision, and not only diligent, but determination. What does that mean? It means you've got to stay in the game for the long haul. Change doesn't happen overnight. Change, this is not get rich quick. This is not get blessed quick. See, oftentimes in our instant society, we are looking for instant faith and instant results, and it doesn't work like that, you guys. There are many people in the Bible that had instant miracles, and there are many people in the Bible who it took decades for things to happen. Took years for reforms to take place. Took a long time for stuff to finally get going and finally get moving. And God wants all of us to take courage. He wants us to stay in there through the process. Wants us to keep our hearts right. You're gonna have to fight for change. It's gonna be something that the devil sees that, oh, you've made the decision. It's a godly desire. You want something from the Word of God. And now all of a sudden the opposition comes. You start getting diligent, you get wore out. Start getting after something, you get sick. Start something happens in the marriage and all of a sudden there's a breach. Why? Because the devil is not happy with you changing the world you live in. He wants you to stay down. He wants you to stay the same. And so he's going to oppose you at every turn. But I love what author and speaker John Acuff had to say. He said, a dream that you don't have to fight for isn't a dream. It's a nap. One changes your afternoon. The other changes your world. The degree and intensity you have to fight for something is directly related to how much it matters to you. How much do you really want it? And if you really want it, are you going to cross over the line and make the decision? And once you've made the decision, are you going to put in the work and the hustle that you need to get a hold of it? And if it really matters to you, if you really want it, if you really want to get free, if you really want to have a great marriage, if you really want to be solid in the things of God, if you really want to be blessed and prosperous, if you really want to raise great kids, listen, you cannot raise great kids in a year. It takes a lifetime. And so are you going to be in it for the long haul? How long do you want to pray for that person who's not saved to get saved? Because I don't know about you, most of the people I prayed for to get saved, it took years for them to finally come around church. It takes time. It takes diligence. It takes commitment. It takes staying in there. How long are you willing to wait? See, because the day you give up on your dream, on what it is that you wanted, that desire, that godly thing, you don't know if that could have been the day that God was going to bring your breakthrough. Stay in there. Stay in there. Stay in there through the night. Stay in there through the trial. Stay in there until you see the change. James chapter 1, verse 4. James chapter 1, verse number 4. Look at what it says. New Testament, back to the New Testament. James chapter number 1, right off the bat, verse number 4. Great verse. Look at what it says. It says, "But let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing." That word patience is a great word in the New Testament. You'll find it. Actually, I should have highlighted it. If you guys in the back could highlight that for me. Word patience. Patience in the New Testament, I love how it says it in the Strong's. It talks about this word and it kind of unpacks it and defines it for us. It says patience in the New Testament is the characteristic of someone who is not swerved from deliberate purpose and loyalty to faith, even in the greatest trials and sufferings. See, it doesn't matter come hell or high water. You will go through the fire and you will go through the flood if it's something that you really want. Why? Because if it's a godly desire, you're not just doing it by yourself. And it's not just going to be in your own strength. You can't make change happen on your own. Yeah, you can go so far. But if it's a godly change, you stand there with the word of God and the grace of God will come in and God will bring it to pass. Why? Because if you delight yourself in the Lord, back to the first part of this, he will give you the desires of your heart. My goodness, guys. See, in our instant society, we don't want to wait. We don't want to stop. We don't want to do anything. We don't want to even try sometimes because we've been told that it's not worth the fight. Stay down. Stay put. You can't change anything. That's just the way it is. Listen, I'm here to tell you tonight, that is not the way that it is. I can have what the Word of God says I can have. I can do what God says I can do. I can be who God says that I am. I can have all the promises, all the blessings. I can have abundance. I can have the overflow. Why? Because God promised and God can't lie. David Livingston, many of you guys know who he is, Dr. Livingstone, I presume. Great missionary in Africa, doing a great work with medicine and with the Word of God. And his ministry started to get very popular. People started telling stories. They started getting exciting. I mean, it was adventure. It was very fun. And so people started wanting to go and see the work. They wanted to go and start participating in the work. And so they sent a message to Dr. Livingstone, and they said, "We want to come, we want to see and participate in the work. We want to send some men to you. What's the best road that we can send them on? Which way should they take? What's the easiest way to get to you?" This is what Dr. David Livingstone replied. He said, "If a man will only come if there is a good road, I don't want him. I want men who will come if there's no road at all." Some of you guys have been looking at life and you want change, but it looks like there's not even a place to start. And yet God is saying, how much do you really want it? How great is that desire for change? And then is that desire a godly desire? Because if you can find it in the Word, you can have it in your life. And so God is saying, what are your desires? Are they godly? If they are, you can have them. Secondly, make the decision, cross over, I'm going to have this in my life. It's going to change. It's going to happen. Then start to add some diligence. Get in there, make it happen. Put some hustle in there. Do what you can do. And then finally, determination. Stay in the game. How long should I wait? Until. As long as it takes. Because then God will see. God knows. God knows the time. He knows the season. He knows the way. He knows the channel. He's going to get you that. He knows what he's going to do to bring about that change. If you will stay in there with the word of God, delight yourself in the Lord, he will give you the desires of your heart. Did you guys get something from the word tonight? Hallelujah. Come for the word, stay for the tacos. Praise God. Tonight, before anybody gets up and leaves, I just want to talk to you guys about your life. While everybody remains seated, nobody crunching on Sun Chips. Let's just take a moment. Just give me a couple more minutes of your attention. All right, let's talk about your life. Tonight, I want to make sure before you leave this place that we don't leave you where we left King Agrippa. Remember King Agrippa? Paul, you almost persuade me to become a Christian. I believe there's a lot of people that come into American churches. A lot of people who regularly attend American churches who are kind of almost persuaded. But they haven't yet really crossed over the line. They like the idea of church. They like the idea of God. They really like the idea of heaven, and they don't like the idea of hell. But can I tell you something? This is real, guys. Heaven is real. It's not a fairy tale. It's not just pie in the sky. And hell is also real. It's all throughout the Bible, Old and New Testament. Jesus himself talked about it. Listen, I don't want you to go to hell. You don't want you to go to hell. But more than either of us, God doesn't want you to go to hell. See, God never intended for people to go to hell. He made that place for the devil and his angels who rebelled against him. And yet we can choose with our life because God gives us a gift called free will. And we have the choice to choose with our lives while we're here on the planet where we end up, whether we go to heaven or whether we go to hell. Now listen, we've only got one shot at this. You're not coming back as a frog or a dog or working your way up to something again so that you can finally make it to heaven. It doesn't work like that. We've got this life to live. The Bible says it's appointed for man once to die and then to the judgment seat. And listen, Peter said that judgment starts with the house of God. You know why that is? Because there's a lot of people in church that are almost persuaded to be a Christian, and yet they haven't yet crossed over the line. Sometimes people say, well, Pastor, doesn't all roads lead to heaven? No. Nowhere in the Bible say all roads lead to heaven. That's like me saying all roads lead to the moon. You'd say, what? You're crazy. Think I can just drive around the earth and I'll eventually make it to the moon? Doesn't work like that. There's only one way you're going to get to the moon, yeah? And there's only one way you're going to get to heaven. Can't just do whatever you want to do. Do whatever I tell you to do or what some well-meaning church committee thinks of. Got to get there God's way. It's God's heaven. Got to get there God's way. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and life. No man goes to the Father except by me. So it's God's heaven. We got to get there God's way. Sometimes people think, well, that's good news, Pastor, because I know that God's way is by being good. I've been a really good person, been nice, you know, help my neighbors out, give money to charities. I wear shoes that put shoes on other kids' feet in other parts of the world. I drink water that digs wells in places where they wouldn't have clean water otherwise. That's great. I'm glad you're involved in that stuff. But could you just show that to me in the Bible where that gets you into heaven? I don't want you to stop doing that stuff. Keep doing it. It's cool. It's making a difference. But show that to me in the Bible where that gets you into heaven. Nowhere in the Bible say your good deeds, your good works, your merit gets you into heaven. Because if we want to get to heaven based on our own merit, the standard is perfection. And the only one who is perfect, his name is Jesus. The Bible tells us all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Our goodness compared to God's goodness, the Bible describes it as filthy rags. You're going to get thrown out, not going to get to stay. Can't make it to heaven just by being good. And yet a lot of people think, if I'm just good enough, I'll get there. Nope. Nope. It doesn't work like that. Sometimes people say, well, Pastor, I was raised in church. Parents told me you were Christians growing up. They hung a cross or St. Christopher around your neck, had you baptized or christened as a child, took you to religious classes like Sunday school, Sabbath school, catechism class. You've always thought of yourself as a Christian. Born in America, America's a Christian nation. Everybody born in America is going to heaven, right? Wrong. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that your parents raised you in church, tell you're a Christian, that makes you a Christian? Nowhere in the Bible does it say that you wear religious jewelry, attend religious classes, be baptized or christened as a child, or that because you're born in America that you get to go to heaven. Listen, you think God is just like, oh, they're not any other religions and they were raised in church. I guess they're a Christian and he just throws you into that category. No, it doesn't work like that. And yet a lot of people think that that's what's going to get them into heaven. Sometimes people say, well, you know, Pastor, not only when I was a child did I go to church. Here I am sitting in church right now. I think I'm a Christian because I'm in church. Well, that's like me saying, you know what? I really want to be a Dodger. I think I'm going to throw on a Dodger uniform, go down to the sports store, buy a Dodger uniform, throw it on, bring my bat and my ball, go sit in the dugout, Dodger Stadium, get to play in the game. You know what's going to happen? They're going to find me sitting there, drag me out and lock me up. Why? I'm not a Dodger. And I can't just call myself one and sit in the dugout and think that that's going to allow me some game time. Can't just sit in church, call yourself a Christian. That makes you a Christian. Sometimes people think, well, you know what? I understand that, but you don't understand. My last church, I got involved, helped out, sang in the choir, carried the pastor's Bible, made decisions in that church. People thought of me as a leader. I even got a membership card to that church, taught in the Bible classes. It's great. I'm glad you did those things. Just show that to me in the Bible where your church involvement gets you into heaven. Where you help out, sing in the choir, carry the pastor's Bible, make decisions. People think of you as a leader. You get to go to heaven. God is not looking for your membership card to a church before you can enter the gates of heaven. Sometimes people think, well, okay, yeah, I understand all that, but I got you on this one. Here it is. Ready? I know God. Someone told me that if I knew God, I'm a Christian. I know God. I know about Jesus. I know about Easter and the resurrection. Sing the songs of Christmas every year of my life. I could quote scriptures to you, Pastor. Maybe even some of the ones we read tonight. And while that's great, and I'm glad you can do those things, just show that to me in the Bible where you have head knowledge about who Jesus is that gets you right with God, where you can quote a scripture or celebrate a holiday. Now all of a sudden you get to go to heaven. See, if you'd read your Bible, you know the demons know who Jesus is. They called out his name when he came, Son of God. They knew exactly who he was. They believed he was the Son of God. The devil himself knows who Jesus is and could quote scriptures out of his mouth. Isn't that interesting? And yet that doesn't qualify the devil for going to heaven. Everybody look up here at me for a second. Look up here. This is not about what you have in your head. It's not about having mental assent towards God, knowing who Jesus is, and that gets you right with God. But rather, this is about your heart. Jesus made this statement. He said, if you want to enter the kingdom of heaven, you must be born again. He didn't say be good. He didn't say attend church. He didn't say volunteer. He didn't say know about God. He said you must be born again. Now, I know. I get it. When we hear born again, we think about that movie, we think about that book, we think about that blog, and we think, ugh, born again, I don't want to have any part of that. Well, listen, if you don't have any part of that, you're not going to make it. Why? Because Jesus said that's the way. That's the one way. You must be born again. No other way you're going to make it except that you enter the kingdom of God by being born again. Now, what does that mean? Does it mean what we've seen in Hollywood? Does it mean what we've seen in movies? Does it mean what we've read about? No. Let's let the Bible define for us what being born again is, shall we? From the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, being born again has always meant the same thing. It means that you've given God all of your heart and you've given God all of your life. You're persuaded. You stepped over the line and now you're saying, I'm making the decision and I'm going to give you, God, everything, all that I am, all my heart and all my life. Listen, God already gave you all his heart. God already gave you all of his life in the form of his son, Jesus, beaten, bloody, hung on a cross. He's not asking you to do that, but he's not asking you for any less than that. Will you give God all of your heart? Will you give God all of your life? In a moment, I'm going to give you this opportunity to give God all of your heart and all of your life by simply counting to three and clapping my hands together. Just like this. One, two, three, bang. Just like that. When you hear the sound of my hands popping together, just like that, bang, that's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're acknowledging your need for Jesus. You're saying, I want to cross over that line. I want to be fully persuaded, not like Agrippa, but I want to give God all my heart. I want to give God all my life. I want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up. I'll count it. You can put it right back down. Now, you might be thinking at this point, whoa, wait a second. Time out. Did you just say you're going to point and count? Because that freaks me out. Like, I'll be embarrassed if you do that. Yeah, you might be. Let's get over that embarrassment. Why? Because think of the trade-off. Isn't it better to be embarrassed for a moment than it is to end up in hell forever and ever and ever and ever? No one make that trade. Listen, Jesus said, if you confess me before man, I'll confess you before my Father in heaven. But if you deny me, I will deny you. So tonight, come on, couldn't get any easier than this right here. Just lifting your hand and acknowledging your need for Jesus. Probably won't even be embarrassed. But even if you are, it's better than ending up in hell. Now you've got Jesus on your side. He says, hey, they stepped over the line. They made the decision. They crossed over. And they've acknowledged me before man. And now he says, Father, they're my child. Now you can be headed for heaven, denying your presence in hell. Tonight, front to back, left to right, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, watching by television in the foyer or down at the Love Rock Cafe, our online viewers, wherever you're at, all over the world, get ready to get your hand up because God sees and God's watching right where you're at. Who should raise their hand in a moment if you've been running from God instead of to God? I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand if you're not sure about your salvation? Tonight is your night. Make sure. Who should raise their hand if you've never done this before, never giving God all of your heart and all of your life? I'm speaking to you. Or finally, who should raise their hand? If you're lukewarm in this place and you know that's the condition of your heart when I describe it like this, that you're a little in, little out, little up, little down, little token prayer every now and again, an occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything. You're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, Jesus says, if you're lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. He wants us hot or cold. What's he saying? In or out. Make a decision. Either you are or you aren't. But if you try and play the game and say, I'm almost persuaded, I'm kind of there, but not really yet. He says, listen, it's not going to make it. Tonight is your night of salvation. You ready to get your hands up? I'm going to count to three, pop my hands together. This is your time. This is your moment. Here we go. Are you ready? One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me right now if that's you. You need to give God all of your heart and you need to give God all of your life. Come on, raise it up high for me. Thank you. There's one, two, three, four. Got you guys over here. Anybody else real quick? There's four wise people already. Who else tonight? Need to give God all of your heart? Need to give God all of your... Don't tell me all the unsaved people sat over on this side tonight. Come on, where are you at? We got someone up here? About four, five up there. Got you. Thank you. God bless you. Who else tonight? Six. Got you right there. Anybody else? Listen, I didn't embarrass them. I won't embarrass you. Come on, go for it. If you're sitting there and your heart's pounding on your chest, you're wondering if you should do this, don't stop it. Almost persuaded. Come on. You're not guaranteed tomorrow. This is your night of salvation. Anybody else real quick? About six wise people. Anybody else real quick? Come on. Let's go for God tonight if that's you. Anybody else? Anybody else? Come on. Just raise it up high for me. If you feel that little tug at your heart, that's the Spirit of God saying, come on. Come on. You need to do this. Anybody else? I'm going to give one more call. Take one more sweep, and then I'm going to wrap this thing up. Don't miss this opportunity. You've missed enough opportunities in your life. Anybody else? Anybody else in the middle section here? Anybody else on this side? All right, let's give the Lord a great big praise for about six wise people. Okay. Now remember, that decision needs some diligence behind it. You need to put some action with your decision. Let's not just stop at making a decision. Now let's live it out. Tonight, we want to help you in this new walk with God. We want to help you in this new relationship. You don't get saved just by raising your hand. You get saved when you give God all of your heart and all of your life. So we want to lead you in a prayer. Can't do that till we get you down here. So if that's you, you raise your hand, or you should have raised your hand. You're number 7, 8, 9, and 10. Hey, come on. It's not too late for you. Let's all stand. And if you raise your hand, you should have raised your hand. Get your stuff, get in the aisle, and meet me up front right now. Come on down. Come on down.
This is my...
Come on, let's give them a hand as they come. You can come right now. Just make your way to the front. They're coming.
Lord, with all my heart, I worship you.
They're coming. Come on, if that's you right now, you raise your hand or you should have. Just come on down to the front right now.
It's all that is within me. And I give.
Anybody else? Come on, come on, come on. If that's you, just come on down. If your children raise their hand and they need to come, bring them right now. They'll remember this. Come on, nudge your neighbor. Say, come on, friend, I'll go with you.
Lord, I give you
All right, well, you guys came. All right, I'm going to lead you guys in a prayer tonight. Okay? Simple prayer to invite Jesus in your heart. You're going to be born again. That's the best, all right? Best decision of your life right here, right now. Okay? So we're going to pray. Prayer is simply talking to God. Okay? It's not about the words of your mouth. It's about the expression of your heart right now. So we're going to bow our heads and close our eyes. That kind of helps us to get out of the scene realm, you know, and let's get into God right now. And just say these words out loud to God. Say, Father God. Everybody else, come on, join them with him. Say, Father God, I come to you now in Jesus' name. I give you all of my heart and all of my life. Come into my heart. Forgive me my sin. Wash me and cleanse me and make me brand new. From this day on, Jesus, you are my Lord. That means my leader. And you are my Savior. You've saved me from hell. Thank you, Jesus. Fill me now with your Holy Spirit. And let it be known that from this day on, I am a Christian. I'm headed for heaven. I love you, Jesus. Thank you. Amen. Come on, let's give the Lord a praise. All right. God is so good. I want to introduce you guys to a friend of mine. We talked about that determination, that decision, right? And now you got to be diligent about it, okay? We have some friends who want to help you in your new walk with God, help you to carry out this change that's about to take place in your life, okay? Because you're going to wake up tomorrow morning, you're going to look the same, smell the same, all right? But you're different, different on the inside, okay? So we want to help you and encourage you that. So this is my friend, Pastor Joel, right here waving at you. He's a really good guy. He's going to get some stuff in your hands, some free information, some free literature. It's easy reading, and it's, like I said, free. Free is the F word around here, okay? So you don't have to worry about that other one. We just give away free stuff like the chips you saw, okay? And then he's going to give you free a spiritual personal trainer. What is that? It's a faith-filled friend, okay, who will encourage you in your new walk with God, okay? He'll describe how that works. It's easy, and you need to do it, okay? So if you guys will just make a left turn, follow Pastor Joel. I'll let you come right back out in a couple minutes. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise tonight. Hallelujah.